About 140 million years ago, flowering plants suddenly appeared and quickly diversified on Earth.
Charles Darwin called this rapid explosion an abominable mystery. And over the last 100 years, scientists have struggled to find an explanation.
But after years of painstaking work, scientists from around the globe collaborated on a history-making project to shed some light on this evolutionary puzzle.
By creating the most comprehensive evolutionary history of Earth's flowering plants, called a tree of life, we now have some new answers.
What the?
In evolutionary biology, all life on Earth is part of a single tree of life, or phylogenetic tree. Think of it as a giant map, or family tree, that shows different branches representing how species evolved from common ancestors. There are tree of life models for all different kinds of living things, from bacteria to insects, reptiles, and mammals.
They are crucial for understanding the evolution of species and their relationships with each other. And like so many living organisms, the history of flowering plants is a very long and complicated one.
A big flowering plant bang occurred about 140 million years ago, which saw flowering plant species suddenly explode onto the scene. Before this, non-flowering plants ruled the land. They reproduced using spores or seeds that weren't enclosed. Think of cycads, conifers, ferns, and mosses. Flowering plants, on the other hand, known as angiosperms, developed unique bisexual reproductive structures known as flowers, which turned out to be particularly good at attracting pollinators. Enclosed seeds within fruits also offered protection and better chances for dispersal and survival. Think of an apple tree, where the seeds are tucked inside the fruit, or a sunflower with seeds packed in the flower head. A strawberry plant is also similar in that it produces seeds on the outside of its fruit, while a pea plant encases its seeds within its pods. This is one of the many key adaptations that allowed flowering plants to spread more efficiently and thrive in diverse environments.
Almost every plant we eat has a flower. They're the backbone of our food systems, giving us fruits, vegetables, grains, and nuts.
They support entire ecosystems, provide habitats for countless animals and insects, and are essential for agriculture. They even have industrial uses: cotton, rubber trees, and even biofuels from canola and soybeans. They're the foundation of life on Earth. This is why the creation of the tree of life for flowering plants was so important. So, how was it done?
Developing a tree of life for all 330,000 known species of flowering plants took an enormous effort, and it required 15 times more data than the previous largest study.
Led by the Royal Botanic Gardens Kew in London, this project involved 279 researchers from 27 countries, each contributing a unique area of botanical expertise. Dr. Hervé Soquet is Head of Plant Discovery and Evolution Research at Botanic Gardens of Sydney, and he was one of the co-authors of this exciting study.
So the study is a new comprehensive evolutionary tree or phylogeny or tree of life for all of flowering plants based on brand new genomic data, which we sampled from 9,500 species.
While it was a monumental effort, one of the outcomes of the project was the creation of a conservation tool. By understanding how flowering plants evolved, scientists aim to protect these vital species from mounting threats such as diseases and climate change.
It's an aid for conservation. Basically use it as a map or periodic table to organize future knowledge and future applications.
It can help enable scientists to create informed conservation strategies that address environmental challenges effectively. Botanic Gardens of Sydney played a pivotal role in the project, significantly contributing to its success.
At Botanic Gardens of Sydney, together with a few other herbaria in Australia, we focus on sampling the Australian flora. 88% of it is found nowhere else on Earth. and we collaborated with Kew Gardens to sample 200 specimens, both from our beautiful herbarium collections, but also our living collections. I also played a particular role in leading the database of 200 fossils, which were required to provide a time dimension to our tree of life.
Dr. Hannah McPherson is the collections manager of the National Herbarium of New South Wales at Botanic Gardens of Sydney. She played a key role in ensuring scientists could access the vital collection of herbarium specimens needed for the study.
We have an extensive collection, about 1.4 million specimens here at the National Herbarium of New South Wales, some of which date back as far as 1770, and some were collected yesterday. And so we can access them and extract the DNA, and without that kind of new technology and this large collection and all the other large collections around the world, we really couldn't have conducted a study like this.
With thousands of specimens, how did researchers manage to organise and analyse all the data?
We developed a protocol with stringent controls so that we could follow the specimen from its position in the vault all the way through to preparing it for sequencing. We tracked the data and we also had the priority of care of the specimen top of our mind so that we wouldn't damage that resource.
The team at Royal Botanic Gardens Kew even successfully sequenced extinct plants like the Guadalupe Island olive, which hasn't been seen alive since 1875. By combining today's technology with ancient plant samples, scientists were able to go back to the future. Not with a DeLorean at 88 miles per hour, but with over 9,500 species of plant specimens and 1.8 billion letters of genetic code.
We did two things. First was to reconstruct the evolutionary relationships based on this massive new genomic data set, about 300 genes sampled from 9,500 species. So that meant we had all of the lineages, including from the early radiation of flowering plants. And then the second part, which was very exciting, is we brought in information from 200 fossils, which we use as calibration points, to stretch this tree in terms of geological time and put millions of years on each of the divergences in that tree.
But how did this genetic sequencing help scientists confirm that this sudden explosion in flowering plants likely occurred?
What we found is, by far and large, the very start of the diversification seems to have occurred at a faster rate than later in the history of flowering plants. So not only it happened within a short time window, but there were more lineages being produced per unit of time during that period than on average later in the history of flowering plants. What it does is sort of confirm what Darwin had thought 150 years ago. We could say the mystery continues. It maybe deepens, but at least we have confirmation that there is definitely something extraordinary that happened about 140 million years ago and that changed Earth forever.
The creation of the Tree of Life marks a new era in botanical science, and it creates a new foundation for future research on flowering plant evolution and ecology. There are now plans led by Botanic Gardens of Sydney to expand this study and create the first complete evolutionary tree for all 7,000 native seed plants in New South Wales.
So, the next time you stop to smell the roses or enjoy a piece of fruit, think about the remarkable evolutionary journey flowering plants have undergone and how important it is we continue to protect them for millions of years to come.